So last time we looked at the design of the graphs from a structural point of view. This time we're going to look at the best practices. What we needed to remind from the last time was try to stay as close as possible to the truth. Do not try to manipulate your readers. Never use a 3D graph and try to avoid pie charts. In this session we're going to focus on some of the best practices to create really beautiful graphs. One of the basic chart types was the bar or the column graph. Now, when should you use a bar and when should you use a column? Actually, I do not have a really strong opinion about it, but there are some basic rules. One of the most important aspects, of one of the determining aspects, are your labels. If you look at the two top graphs, then you see, for example, United States doesn't fit on one line if you create it in a column graph. So if you have long labels, it makes sense to create a bar graph or bar chart instead of a column chart. And there is another one. If you look at the bottom left, you see you have a time series there. I could also create a bar chart from it. You can see it at the right, but that's very strange. As soon as you put a time dimension in the vertical axis of a graph, it gets very difficult to understand. Time for us goes from left to right. So if you have a time series and you want to use a bar or a column chart, you should really choose the column chart. Now, with tables, we saw the importance of white space. And for graphs, it's exactly the same. And also there, you have a choice. You have to be aware that your spreadsheet software, in this case Excel, will default it for you. And the default is not always right. And here you see some of the different values that are possible. And I like that the white space is about 100 or about 50%. And I would just like to show you in Excel how you can influence the white space between the different columns. So here we are. I just select all the data. I learned that from Feline. And I say, okay, I'm going to insert a column chart. There it is. And I really do not like the amount of white space that I see over here. For me, this is too much. And I want to change that. So I select one of the columns. It doesn't matter which one. I right click. I format the data series. And then, over here, I can adjust the gap width. And I will put it, and I like to type it in, I will put it to 50%. And for me, I think this is better readable. But for me, important is that you understand you have a choice there, and you should think about it, what it will do with your message. Now, this is a very old one. At some point in time, we had matrix printers. They could not print colors. And we created graphs, and we used different fill patterns to make sure to distinguish the different categories we had in our chart. And they're still around. And because they're around, people are still using them. But please don't do that. On the other hand, be aware that even today, not everybody has the ability to print in color. So if it's printed, and if you're not quite sure that they can color print it, use grayscales. And if you know that your graph is either color printed or being on a screen, then this is really the best option. Use colors with a good contrast to distinct between the different categories in your data series. Now, what about legends? This is the standard by Excel. It puts it to the right. And let's think a little bit back of the data ink ratio. So what I see here is it's to the right. It's taking space. And I would actually like to use that space for my graph. And there is a frame around it that really doesn't add something to the graph. So what we could do very easily is put the legend to the bottom. Now I have more space for my graph. I do not have the useless border, and I'm really using my pixels in a good way. Now another one, remember the very first chart that we saw in the previous video. It was the sales are skyrocketing graph. One of the things the creator of that graph did was playing with the aspect ratio. And you can overstate and understate the increase that data is actually making. I like my graphs to have an aspect ratio from 1 to 1.5. I think 1 to 2 is overstated, and the 1 to 1 or even the 3 to 2, that's really understated. But be aware that you influence your reader with the aspect ratio and that you really can change it if you create a graph in Excel. Now, another problem is that sometimes we have a lot of data and we want to show it. Now, our short-term memory can handle 7 things, but actually putting 7 variables in one graph is really not easy to understand. I would say 5 is the max, and even that, if I could somehow present the data without putting it all in one graph, I really would do that. But as a rule of thumb, 5 is the max. If it's more than 5, you have to find another solution. Now, what could that other solution be? Here we have a table. We now know this is a unidirectional table with a hierarchical presentation of 2 categories, namely the distribution channel and the region. And there's quite some information going on here. I have a distribution channel, direct sales, distributor sales, reseller sales. I have the 4 regions. I have the bookings, the orders that I got in, and I have the billings. And I want to represent somehow this in a graph. But that's too much data to put in a single graph. What you could do, instead of creating one graph, is creating several smaller graphs. And I have an example for that over here. So what we see here is we organized it horizontally, and we organized it by distribution channel. To the left I have direct sales, to the right I have reseller sales. And what you see, for example, if you look at the labels on the y-axis, I only have created them for the most left chart. The other charts don't need a label because they can borrow the label from the first chart. So you're looking at 3 different charts, but on the other hand, they're also one complete chart. The same for the legend. I only have the legend in there once because it's the same for all the 3 graphs. And still, I have a lot of choices how I'm going to present the data, and there's no rule for it, what is the best way? Because it's depending on what I want to tell. If I want to focus on distribution channel, this would be a very good option. But maybe I want to focus on region. And then I would shuffle the data a little bit and putting the region in the columns. Or I could do something completely different, because the trouble here is if I want to, for example, compare the bookings of West and the bookings of South, then I can do it, but it is difficult to see the difference in length. It would be easier if it would be presented vertically. So that would be another choice. And that brings us to the end of some of the best practices to create very nice looking graphs. In this session you got a lot of theory about how to design your tables and how to design your graphs. In the session of next week we're going to bring this all together and create our own dashboard. Hope to see you back next week.